Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.
Good afternoon and welcome to the City Club. I'm Darrielle Snipes, a reporter and producer at IdeaStream, and it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Susan Hall, with the Cleveland History Center of the Western Reserve Historical Society, and Dr. E. Faye Williams, president of the National Congress of Black Women Incorporated. Today marks the 49th anniversary of the assassination of Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., a tireless advocate for social justice and racial equity. The day after Dr. King's assassination, Senator Robert F. Kennedy spoke at the City Club right here. The speech is known by the signature phrase, "the mindless menace of violence." In that speech, Senator Kennedy said, "We must admit the vanity of our false distinctions among men and learn to find our way our own advancements in the search for the advancement of all. We must admit in ourselves that our children's future cannot be built in the misfortune of others. And we recognize that this short life can neither be ennobled or enriched by hatred or revenge." That history is with us today as we welcome our speakers today. Hold on one second. I have a lot of papers. Reverend Dr. E. Faye Williams is an attorney, businesswoman, teacher, and activist for peace and human rights. As the president and CEO of the National Congress of Black Women, she serves as a nonpartisan voice on issues pertaining to the appointment of women at all levels of government and to increase minority women's participation in the education, political, economic, and social arenas. Prior to this role, Dr. Williams has served in a variety of governmental positions, including serving as formal counsel to the U.S. Congress D.C. Subcommittee on the Judiciary and Education. Dr. Williams is a lifetime member of Delta Sigma Theta and is a triple doctor. Yes, I know there are a lot of deltas in the house. And a triple doctor holding 3 doctoral degrees, a PhD in public administration from the City University of Los Angeles, a Juris Doctor from Howard University School of Law, and Doctor of Ministry from Wesley Theological Seminary, and an author of 4 books. Help me welcome Dr. Williams. And we have Susan Williams, Director of Community Relations and Curator at Cleveland History Center of the Western Reserve Historical Society. Susan is from Brooklyn, New York, but moved here to Cleveland in the early 80s. She is a Cleveland State alum, and she also went to Boston University. She got her Master's of History here at Cleveland State University, and she is also a Delta. Welcome, Susan. So as you all know that the Reverend Al Sharpton was supposed to be here but was delayed by flight, he will be missed, but we're still going to have a great conversation with these powerful and amazing ladies, that's for sure. So let's start with this somber occasion of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King on this day 49 years ago. While he was alive, he did a lot of great work to bring social justice and equality to blacks and minorities. You know, in the light of everything that's been happening with President Trump becoming president, do you think his legacy will be threatened these days with everything that's been happening?
I would say absolutely not, because I think what Dr. King taught us was to have that resilience and that resolution to keep moving in spite of being knocked down. You know, one of my favorite sayings is one that he said about if he felt that the world was going to fall to pieces, he would still plant his apple tree. Well, there are some of us who are determined to continue to plant those apple trees and to make his legacy go on and move forward. And not only that, but to have dreams of our own. Not so long ago, I was in Morocco, and one of the pleasures of that trip was to find out that Dr. King is remembered not only here in the United States, but around the world. The mayor of a key city there had little, you know, pieces of remembrance of Dr. King in her office. And everywhere I go in the world, I find that. So Dr. King was important not only to us in the black community, but in the entire United States and the entire world. There is no way we're gonna let it fall apart. We just, it motivates us to keep moving on. And when you add Shirley Chisholm, who is my predecessor, then of course you've got something to reckon with here with women. Women are great, they've done great things, and we will continue to do it. We don't allow anything to keep us from doing what we know must happen. And we know that continuing human rights, and I consider women's rights to be human rights also, but I consider the fact that we will never ever let Dr. King down and all of those great women and men who fought for human rights and for justice in this country. We have a responsibility to make sure that we move on and upwards.
All right. That's fine. Go ahead.
The legacy is strong. The legacy is rich. The roots are deep. The attack has always been ongoing, regardless of the administration, whether it's supportive or not so supportive, as we are seeing right now, so it seems. So the fight to justice, the fight to equality is about, I'm gonna come as the historian. That's the space I tend to live in. We have to look back to move forward as well, and it's nothing new. This is what we're accustomed to. I've heard a lot of millennials say, you know, don't mess with me because I'm not my grandmother. Well, you better know what your grandmother did. You need to know how they fought. And maybe the fight wasn't with bricks and mortar and guns and fists, but we were in the trenches. People died, not just Dr. King. Many people died. Many unsung heroes, sheroes, fought and died and perished and were maimed and harmed and are still incarcerated today as terrorists of the state, if you will. All for what? Fighting for equity. Fighting for rights, fighting for justice and humanity, and not just for African Americans. We take that for granted oftentimes, that the fight is for just for people of color or just for black people. But if it's justice for one, it will ultimately be justice for all. So the legacy is strong, and how do we rally back together so that our young people, my young people, I have millennial children, understand where we've come, what was sacrificed to get to next.
And Susan mentioned terrorists. Please know that a terrorist is not always something bad. If you've ever seen particularly a black woman terrorist who is fighting for what is right, and we do fight for what is right, then you have not seen it, because you really need to see that. We had women years ago who fought for us even when they, you know, you would have thought that they were women without much education, without anything, you know, going for them. They didn't have Mercedes-Benz, they didn't have cell phones, they didn't have all the things that we have with which to fight today. So I wrote a book after a trip to the Middle East some years ago called The Peace Terrorist. And the reason I called it The Peace Terrorist is that we were a group of women out on the sea. We had traveled from Malta to Tunisia, through the Suez Canal, through Libya, all the way to Oman, United Arab Emirates, all around, you know, trying to prevent a war. Now, we were not successful in preventing that war because we were held up by a group of soldiers out on that water, most of whom were American soldiers. And we had guns drawn on us, women were beaten, etc. Babies were threatening to be thrown overboard. And I saw one young man who gave me hope. It was a young man, 19 years old, who was holding a gun on us. He had tears in his eyes. And when we asked him, why are you doing this? And he said, we were told we had to do it this way. Well, there are some things we have to do a certain way, and we don't have to use violence, you know, in terms of terrorism, but the word terror means that you put terror in the enemy so that they stop doing what they are doing to you, and it doesn't have to be through violence.
All right. Good. 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 So, Susan, you're working on an exhibit for Carl Stokes, you know, the 50th anniversary of him being elected as the first African American to a mid-sized city here in Cleveland. It sounds like you want to say something. No, but
major American city.
But you know, you're working on that exhibit, and you know, interesting. I guess you know, I didn't realize this, but King was here on the night that he was elected.
Yes.
And he came here many times. Can you just talk about the relationship that King and the Stokes brothers had with him?
Sure. Dr. King came here many times. He was friends with many individuals, particularly the clergy. He was friends with Reverend Cavanaugh at Greater Abyssinia. We just recently did an oral history where he expounded mightily on that. So going forward, everyone here will be able to hear that whole interview about his experiences with Dr. King and the SCLC. He came with Reverend Hoover at Olivet. He was very close friends with Carol Hoover as well. And I don't want to keep naming names because I'll forget somebody, so that's enough for there. But he came, his first visit was in 1960. And it was a dual role to help garner support from a Midwestern city for the things that were happening in the South, to help support and bolster financially and collective spirit of support for efforts for voting rights and integration, et cetera, in the sit-ins, et cetera, in the South. He also came back all throughout Carl's election period to bolster voting rights and registration. So we didn't have the same situation going on in Cleveland in the South, but people were not always registered to vote, just like they are not now, and did not always exercise their right to vote and needed encouragement to go do so. Many of the African Americans in Cleveland, it's called Alabama North, so the migration pattern predominantly comes from Alabama. So people who were coming from Alabama through the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and the 60s were not accustomed to being able to vote, being poll taxes and all the other things that maligned and restricted blacks from voting. So he came to do rallies. There were big rallies. Anybody in this room been here longer than, say, 20 years knows about pick and peg. So there's great pictures at Western Reserve Historical Society in the archives of Dr. King holding these big rallies to get people to vote. And he spoke at Addison Junior High School, at Glenville High School. So on the night of Carl Stokes' election in 1967, there were, it was at the Old Bon Court, for those who know it as the Bon Court, is now the Westin. And there are no images of Dr. King. And I say that because sometimes people say, oh, it didn't happen because I didn't see it. There's no white paper trail, there's no photograph, there's no film footage. Well, a very conscious decision was made to not have Dr. King come into the room for the returns at the hotel. So he and Lou Stokes were up in the hotel room watching it on television. So that's why there are also no pictures of the night of the return and the celebratory events with Carl and his brother. So they were upstairs in the room watching the returns because they didn't want to distract, detract, and shift the focus on how Carl was elected to Dr. King or from Dr. King, make it about that. It wasn't about that. Carl won on his own volition. It was coalition politics. It's really the first of its kind in this country. There was only 37% African Americans in the city of Cleveland. So even if every man, woman, and child voted for Carl Stokes, he probably could not have been elected mayor. So he worked hard and tirelessly to build a coalition of voters who supported him, east side and west side, black, white, Hispanic, etc. And he was able to triumph at that point. And what makes his election so historic in nature, the first major American city to have a, as his first line of his book, to govern a major city that was majority white. That's telling. But at the same time that was happening, he was charismatic. He had ideas, but he wasn't a new politician. He had already been a state rep. He ran prior to that and lost against Locher to a very small margin. And then he went on to beat Seth Taft, who was the grandson of a former United States president. And Carl and Lou Stokes are the great-grandsons of former slaves. So we are able to see how that shifted the narrative in American history. after Hatcher won simultaneously, but in Gary, Indiana, was not considered a major city. Different type of demographics as well at the time. But that led and opened the floodgates for others. Maynard Jackson, Coleman out of Detroit, Harold Washington later, David Dinkins, which was even much later than that, Tom Bradley out of Los Angeles. So King was here helping often. So there are lots of images of him helping and doing voter rallies, but that night he allowed, they all elected to allow him to fall back and let Carl's new power base and election rise up to where it should have been.
Susan mentioned integration, which was one of the problems when Dr. King was working. And by the way, I am chronologically advanced enough to have known Dr. King. we don't use the word old here, you understand. But integration, we're somewhat past working on integration now, but we certainly are still working on immigration. And I mentioned immigration to say that there is a reason that we have to form coalitions, because many times we're talking about human rights. And so all of these are human rights. When we add women's rights, we add, immigrants' rights and LGBT. I mean, there are just so many people who are still out there fighting for their rights. And the reason we don't win these battles more easily is that we don't often see the connection of these things. So we've got to start seeing the connection. I'm a daughter of the South, so I remember a lot of the things that you talked about happening in the South as I was in school there. And I ran for the United States Congress. No one in my state who looked like me had ever run for office before. I was the first African American to run for the United States Congress there. And of course, Congresswoman Mary Rose Olcott was one of those people in Congress at that time who supported me. And even though we didn't get credit for the win, I won't say we lost because we didn't. After I'd been announced as the winner in the congressional race, there was a mysterious computer breakdown. Yep. And when it came back on, I was told I lost by 0.6%. So I'm known as Louisiana's Congresswoman in exile, even today. So wherever I am, I have to remember my brothers and my sisters in the South who had many worked with Dr. King and worked with Fannie Lou Hamer, worked with many of the others. We cannot forget our past, because as you can see, history can repeat itself, particularly with the administration we have now. But we should be stronger today, and we should be more understanding of the fact that we have to form coalitions with so many different groups. We don't have to agree with them on everything, but on our issues, we must bring them together. I mean, sometimes my white sister friends, want to pass the Equal Rights Amendment. And I say, fine, I want to pass it too. I am a woman. But then I also want the Voting Rights Act secured. So you see, we do have things in common. If you help me on voting rights, then I can certainly be there to help you on equal rights and then all of the other groups that I've mentioned. So we've got to learn to do that. No matter how much we dislike somebody on one other issue, we can work together on some issues.
So let's talk about the election and of President Trump. Tina Fey was talking recently just of how she's angry at college-educated white women who voted for Trump. And talk about how women could vote for him and how black women rallied together to vote against him.
Well, forget about the Russians right now. I do have to have what they did to the election, but. I have to have a talk every time I see them with my white sisters to say, those were your fathers, your brothers, your uncles, your nephews, your spouses who prevented our winning an election that was in our best interest. Black women vote, and when we vote, we know how to vote in our best interest. And that's one of the things we're trying to teach our white sisters. And many of them will tell me, they betrayed us. We were there, 7%, 97%. We voted the way we had agreed we were going to vote of the candidate who was in our best interest. But white women will tell you they betrayed us, they let us down. But you see, the difference there is that many of them have their fathers, their sons, their grandfathers to go back to and, get things through their wills and whatever. We don't have that. So we have to be fighting all the time. But I would encourage you, my sisters, I love all of you. but you need to come together with us on some of the things that we're working on to make life better for us, to help everyone recognize that we too are human beings. And when we do that, we can help you to become the powerful women that we know you can be. When we all get together, there is nothing that we cannot resolve. So please, next time, understand your best interest is also our best interest, and ours is yours. Thank you.
And so yesterday, Attorney General Jeff Sessions ordered the Justice Department to review all police reform agreements, including the one right here in Cleveland. In the memo, he said that it is to ensure public safety. Now, the reason many consent decrees happen is because of the death of black men and women at the hands of police. How do you feel that this can impact the safety of minorities if they are possibly reversed or changed in any way?
Well, I think it's going to be a challenge to us if these things are reversed. And then I think we can go back and we can look at Dr. King's legacy, and what he stood for was making all of us more human, seeing each other as human beings. When we talk about investigating police departments, we're not suggesting that all police are evil. But at the same time, we must acknowledge that some have done some evil things. And my nephews and my brother and all who are police officers probably don't enjoy having me say this, but I believe they know it, and they know that this is an area in which we have to work on in order to make the streets safe for me as a black woman, to make the streets safe for all women, all people, as a matter of fact, all children. And when we do that, and we do it not in anger, but we do it out of love for wanting to perpetuate the human race and including everybody in that, then I think we can work together. What Attorney General Sessions is doing is exactly what we knew he would do, and which is why that election now becomes so important, because he was placed there by grabber-in-chief, who has no interest in making things better for many of us. So we have to look back to him, and hopefully by the before 2020, but 2018, we can get together and understand the importance of who we're electing, who is going to be working for or against us in that matter, and we can do it. When you put the coalitions together that I've talked about, there is nothing we cannot do, and we don't have to wait until 2020. 2018 has its own elections, and we can see now that we wound up in this strange position of being in the same position as the Freedom Caucus when it came to the health plan. But, I mean, that's an interesting position in which to be. But the point is, you take your help from whenever it comes when you're working for the right thing. So we have to work. We have to appreciate our police officers or lawmen and women when they're doing the right thing. But we also need to be able to look at them when they're not doing the right thing. So I think that will set us back if we allow it to, and we don't get up and elect the right people to make sure that people like Jeff Sessions are not there taking away the progress that we know we have made and we can continue to make. As a saying, you know, I'm so glad trouble don't last always. It doesn't have to last always.
That's right.
I'd like to add to that. And some may find it unpopular, but if it's rollback, what's different? Really, what's fundamentally different if it gets rolled back? We still have the same charge, to be diligent, to stick together, to find and build new coalitions. And at some point, it's not just a black and white issue. And I will fall and die on my sword of being a black woman, but at the same time, it's not just a black issue. The things that are happening to other people. They're just not bringing it to the forefront. Maybe not in the same numbers. We are over-incarcerated, underrepresented, all these other things we know, but so are other individuals as well. And until other people, whatever that is, whites, Latinos, Hispanics, Asians, however you look at it, Muslims, Arabs in America, immigrants, realize that, and the poor, and poverty is a key part of that, say that this is a human issue. And it's not just black people fighting for black people's rights, that the Tamir Rice situation is just wrong on every level. And it's not just because he was black, that's part of the problem. But it's not the only problem. So until we get other people in line to say, damn, that was really wrong. You know, you can see that video and it hurts your heart, and it should. And those that it doesn't, they have no heart. So how do we build these coalitions to further advance the cause? Because on our own, I'm not a math person, but I tend to start playing this number game about this. We are African Americans, about 13% of the population. I don't care what we all do, we could all get, and we don't walk in a lockstep anyway, politically, socially, economically, how we wear our hair, how we dress, all of that, we got a whole lot of different silos. But if we all stood up with a gun, we couldn't, we're outnumbered and outgunned. So, A, we need to have our own cohesiveness as well, but there needs to be a rallying cry for what's right and what's just outside of the community. And other communities need to either recognize and stop running away from, because we tend to be the black boogie person that lives under the bed, whether it's a baby Tamir or grown men Castile, you know, who are unarmed and are now dead because someone decided to be the judge, the jury, and the executioner all on the same day, all because of what they saw and their perceptions. So there are like-minded people of every hue and every religion, every race, who are not standing in the fold. Alone, we don't have enough juice and enough power just because of numbers, not because we're not fierce and fighters and warriors, because we are all that. But at the end of the day, we need what? Assistance for what's right and what's just.
I'm always following up on what Susan says because she says such important things. But we have to remember that we're all human beings and nothing human should be alien to any of us. I'm not the first one who said that, but I think it's an important statement. And one of the things I know about my ancestors is that we have always had to struggle for whatever we have gotten wherever we were. We're always in a mold where we struggle. But you know what I like about us is that we do it without anger. We do it without fear. We do it without jealousy. And that's where we want to bring everyone in, because whatever rights we have ever fought for, that our ancestors have ever fought for, they have benefited all people. Dr. King didn't just work for my rights as a black woman. He didn't, many of the people I named earlier didn't just fight for my rights as a black person or whatever, or as a progressive or any of the things that I am. They fought for all of us to understand the humanity in all of us. And so let us continue in that way, not to be angry about anything that happened in our past, particularly if we don't plan to stand up and do something to change it. You know, many people will sit around and moan and groan and complain about how bad things are. But when you ask them to go to work, to change, or to make a difference, that's where you lose them. We've got to all start standing up. Doesn't matter what color, what gender, whatever we are, we've got to start standing up together, because anyone can slap me down. I mean, it's happened to me a lot of times. They can slap any one person down who's fighting for something. But when you've got a whole group, I mean, just remember back to January 21st. Remember that day when people came out, and those weren't just women. There were men, there were women, there were white people, there were Arabs, there were Native Americans, there were Hispanics, there were young people, older people, chronologically advanced people. I mean, they were there, and we were together, and it was the most wonderful day. It was almost like many of you will remember the Million Man March some years ago, of which I served as co-chair of that march. There were no fights. There was no anger. We got to get that spirit and that spirit we had on January 21st back so that we can work together. We can make the changes that we need and the kinds of things that Dr. King talked about so many years ago.
And so we have... So we have things like the Black Lives Movement and women's rights and, you know, LGBT and Hispanics, you know, with immigration. You know, everyone's working for their own common cause. But like you were just saying, how do we get everybody together so that, you know, we all have a different agenda. So, but how do we come together so that we can show our forces in numbers to get some things done, like you said, for all of us?
Well, first of all, just be there. I mean, I don't care. You know, I am a Dick Gregory disciple, and when I see something going on down the street, somebody protesting, I just say, what are you protesting about? And if it's a cause I believe in, I say, just give me a minute. I run to my car, get a sign out, and I've got the right sign to let them know that I support them. And I mean, I have gone all over this world and protested some places that I didn't even know what the laws were there, and I'm a lawyer. I've been in Japan, I've protested with the workers. I have been in Morocco, I've protested there with people. I've protested all over in London for the people who suffered from BP, the BP oil spill, went to their headquarters. You know, you just can't have fear, because if you've got fear, then you're gonna stay back. But when you are looking for the right thing, you want to do the right thing, then you're looking for the right thing to do. And the right thing is to go and join them. And ultimately, you know, they come to join you. That's about all I can say is, but I've got to commit to being there first and not wait for somebody else to come to my cause.
And I believe you have to get in where you fit in.
Yeah.
There's a role for everybody. And there's an opposition group, and there's a pro group, and you don't have to be friends with them. But you got to understand what they're doing too. So we need to pay attention to what their strategy is, what their languages are, and who's a member of that camp that's coming for your head every day. Some of us walk around, or they walk around with in sheep's clothing. You don't know that that's really, they're against our rights, your rights, somebody else's rights. But you get in where you fit in. I have not necessarily been an active, I was not a child of, I was a baby in the movement. That's the best way to put that. So I couldn't make a conscious decision during the 60s and 70s to join protests because I was a kid. But as an adult, I came up in a period where we were in that lull of almost sleepwalking. You know, you can do whatever you want to do, Susan. It's okay. And I lived in New York, but I'm a child of Southern parents. Yeah, but I found out different. I got to Boston. Boston was horrible. It was one of the worst segregated, racist places I ever encountered in my life. I'd rather have been in Mississippi, quite frankly, than to have been in Boston at that time. The 80s, post the busing, violence, etc. We were told, can't go over there, don't go over there. I never went to a Celtics game. We were afraid to go into South Boston. We didn't go to the store at night unless we went in pairs. It was horrible in that regard, but Boston is supposed to be so progressive and the seat of, you know, the Revolutionary War, blah, blah, blah. And at the end of the day, it's dangerous all over the place for people of color or people who are different or people who don't think the same. So you either give money, you march, you walk, you organize, you email, you support, man, woman, child. I have friends who, like, I take my kids, my own 21-year-old went to her first die-in post, I can't remember, too many people were killed by police in the last couple of years, but she's at school laying on the ground with her sign, and this is one too many was something to the effect of her slogan at the age of, say, 20. But because in the 70s, late 70s, early 80s, we weren't marching like that anymore. We thought we had arrived. Falsely so, but a lot of floodgates and a lot of opportunities were available. We could live where we wanted to live for the most part, go to school where we wanted to go to school. We were being maligned and arrested at higher rates, especially in the 80s with crack and et cetera. But those of us who had pedigrees and degrees and the rest thought, you know, that's them and not us. And now we find out it's, you know, all of us. It affects somebody in our family. So if they're not dead from some other violence in the street, whether it's police perpetrated or our own perpetration, because the system has got us so disenfranchised and broken to that, there's a preponderance of people that, so where do you fit in? Which area? Mental health. And these are things we talk about, and I'll bring it up. I'll be very self-serving on this. In the sororities and fraternities, all of them have different committees that deal with those things, whether it's education, mental health, international causes. Find your group, find your organization at your church, and get involved. You have to pick and choose what it is that works for you. I may not be the one on the front lines marching with a banner, but I may be the one in a background, which is where I tend to like to be. Thank you, Al Sharpton, for having me out front today. but we tend to be the organizer, to organize and make it happen. The Bayard Rustin, if you will. How does that happen? He was not the one out front, but he was the one who really pushed and organized lots of the things, Ella Baker and the rest. There's so many people that made the March on Washington happen. All the people who were Dr. King on the day that he was assassinated. There's like 12 people standing outside on the balcony. He was not alone. And we tend to forget that. So there's a role for everybody in this room. All you young people, figure out what that is, where you fit in, what's your strength. If you're a writer, then you write. If you're an artist, you make signs. You make films, you make documentaries, you do YouTube stuff and Instagram videos so that your word and your voice and our voice and the voiceless are heard.
I had the honor of attending Grambling State University, a little school down in Louisiana, where we had the best of sports. Eddie Robinson taught the young men as well as the young women that we could do anything we wanted to do so long as we were willing to pay the price. And some of us have got to start thinking about not who is doing something, but what they are doing. If we put aside who is doing it and it's the right thing to do, then we can form those coalitions that I talked about earlier and we can accomplish so, so very much more. And we have to not be afraid. I mean, fear keeps us from having some of the experiences of our lives. You know, we get to know people sometimes, and sometimes we don't get to know them because we're afraid to meet them. We've heard terrible things about certain people, but we need to get to know them ourselves and to want to be with them and ask them questions and share our sorrows, share our challenges, share the good times and in our lives with them. And you'd be just amazed at how many people we could get along with. Even though they may be in a different party, they may be of a different culture, let's not be afraid to sit down and be human with one another. That's one of the things that I think we can do in order to make things better for all of us, because as Solomon Burke has a song that says, as long as some of us are not free, none of us are free.
Ladies, thank you so much. Today we're enjoying a forum with Reverend Dr. E. Faye Williams, Esquire, President and CEO of the National Congress of Black Women, Incorporated, and Susan L. Hall, Director of Community Relations and Curator at the Cleveland History Center of the Western Reserve Historical Society. We're going to begin the audience Q&A, and we welcome questions from everyone, City Club members, guests, students, or those who are just visiting us via webcast. If you'd like to tweet a question, please tweet it at the City Club, or the staff will try and work it into the program. And we want to remind you that your question should be brief and to the point. Holding the microphones today are content coordinator Teddy Eisenberg and director of programming Stephanie Jansky. May we have our first question, please?
Hi, good afternoon. Hi, I'm William Tarter, and thank you very much for a very fruitful discussion today and very thoughtful. I really appreciate it. So when I look at the current state of affairs, I see a lack of empathy. A lot of people who are trying to articulate their position but not quite understanding the thoughts and positions of others. When we look at history and we see movements that have made progress, it is that coalition building and bringing people together. What principles can we rely on from the past that we can use now in the present to help bring people to understand our issues or for us to understand their issues in order to build that empathy and coalition building to move forward?
Well, I would say you cannot change a person's heart through legislation. And I'm going to quote something I just heard recently from Reverend E.T. Cavanaugh. He said he was a Republican. And so as I was doing this interview with him, I said, what does that mean? He said, there are good Republicans and there are bad Republicans. There are good Democrats and there are bad Democrats. So instilling empathy is a more spiritual kind of thing to me and not a legislative moment. So I don't know that there is a hard and fast means to changing people's hearts and belief systems when they are so entrenched generation after generation after generation. If that empirical, if you will, evidence in a video of an unarmed 12-year-old boy getting shot in record time with a car that drove up on a curb doesn't change his heart, I'm not sure what there is to do. I don't want to be so negative and be a downer, but I'm not sure what you could do to change somebody's heart except for maybe to pray for them and to keep exposing them to those things. And not when they happen to people that don't look or think the same way, but when it's happening to people just like them. Because it is. It's not just happening to one segment of our population. So, and then when it happens to someone who doesn't look like you or look like us, then we gotta rally around that one too, because wrong is wrong. And we tend not to do that right now. So when a young, say white child is killed unarmed by a police officer, where's Black Lives Matter on that one? Because if it's right to be against something, then we need to step up and do that too, whether they want us there or not. And that may build some empathy, because it would also build some solidarity to say, you know what, dang, that happened too. Yes, there's disparity right now in the legal system with opiate addiction and treatments versus jail that we didn't have with crack and cocaine. But at the end of the day, young people, black and white, are dying. So why are we, yes, we need to say this is wrong. There's this disparity. How do we correct that? We can't fix all the ones that are past, sadly. There are people doing life for some little vial of stepped on crack. But there are people dying, black and white, right now of opiates. What do we do? So if we are supportive of people who may not support us on the same moment, maybe that will change their heart.
And in addition to what Susan said again, I think we have to learn to tell each other's story. When we know something good about someone, let's tell that instead of the negative things that we've heard someone say about a person. I have a friend who happens to be black, and he told me of a young man in Florida, one of the more exclusive hotels, was working as a lifeguard, and they just started to talk. And the young man told him the story of his life, that when he started medical school, his father was living but had died, so that sort of cut back on some of the monies he had to go to medical school. And as he progressed to his senior year, his mother passed away. And he was here having to get a job as a lifeguard to try to finish medical school. But then he worked two shifts. And as he worked those two shifts, he was called in one day and told that he could only work one shift because people were complaining that they thought with his working two shifts, he was really black because he had become so tan from working those two shifts. So they took away one of those shifts from him to satisfy these customers, these bigoted customers. So he told the young man, okay, call my wife and tell her how much you need to finish medical school and she'll send you the check for it. This was a young white man, and the black man who was saying, call my wife and she'll send you the check. She did. He was able to finish medical school. I should hope that that young man would talk about what this black man did for him. And we have so many stories like that where we could say good things about people and help someone who may not like you just because of your culture or the color of your skin, but we can tell positive stories about them. And then we would be honoring Dr. King and what he stood for.
I want to say how much I appreciate this panel and what's going on this afternoon. I taught school for many years, and I really believed in my students knowing their history. So I would show a number of videos and create lesson plans around them, like Eyes on the Prize. And one of the hardest things I've ever had to do in my teaching career was to get my ninth graders to see nonviolence as a strength instead of a weakness. And it, Susan, you reminded me of that when you said, you know, millennials said, I'm not my, you know, my your grandma, whatever. But it was so hard. So how do you get young people, you know, with violence being celebrated and the videos and so forth, how do you get young people to see that it was courage and not cowardice that caused our ancestors to not fight back? Because it was really nonviolence that made that movement successful. So how do you do that?
I think one of the things they should do is take their children, because I bring it back to the parents, Maybe they're not learning what they need to know in school, but take their children down south to Selma and let them see the story of what happened to Amelia and what happened to John Lewis and others on that bridge, what they went through just to gain the right for all of us to vote. They should take them to Birmingham, to take them to that church where those little girls died, and look at that park where the dogs are clawing at these young children, and show them all of the things that people went through for them to have what they have today, and that they now owe it to our ancestors, you know, to respect what they did and to do something even greater than their grandparents and great-grandparents did. I think it's about character building in the home. We can't just blame it on the schools because the teacher has 30, 40 kids, whatever. I don't know how many more. I'm a former teacher and a former law professor, too. But I think we depend too much on the schools to give our children what we should be getting at home. And when the parents at home don't know it, those of us in the community who do know, we have a responsibility to help to teach the parent and the children. And so that's where our churches come in. That's where our sororities come in. That's where mentoring comes in. We can all do something to help young people and not just say, oh, it's their problem, not mine, because it is our problem as long as our world is falling apart, as it seems to be doing today. Even with the election, it seems that we're falling apart. But we've got to step in and we've got to make sure it doesn't, because I know my ancestors went through too much, experienced too much, to have us just sit back now and say nothing we are doing can do any good.
Thank you, ladies, both. Today's Equal Pay Day. So I'm eager to hear, I know we're saying 20%, but Latino women are still paid less by 46%, and Black women are still paid less by 37%. And you talked about how we all need to be working together and uplift this. So what is the response today, or the action that we as women need to leave to band together to try to get this equal pay to where we're not just talking about it, but we're being about it?
Thank you for asking that question. This little thing right here, I wear it every day to remind everybody to ask me what it means. And it means, it talks about equal pay for women. We need an equal rights amendment. That's what I mentioned before, so that we can get paid for our worth. Women have, just like Black people and others, have never been paid for our worth. But when we put it in the Constitution, it will make a difference. You see, anyone can come in and can change an executive order or something like that, or can change the legislation. We've got to get it in our Constitution. So when you leave this meeting, all you've got to do is call your member of Congress and say, we want to pass the Equal Rights Amendment this year. We've been working on this how long? 40, 50, whatever, years. And it's time now for us to get that Equal Rights Amendment. And we don't get it, it's our fault as women that we have not insisted that we are worth as much as anybody else. So a simple call to your legislator. And do you see how those people, you know, they acted just like the Tea Party this year? When they were going to get rid of Obamacare, did you see them going out there? People of all kinds. They weren't just Black people. In fact, we kind of got a rest. We got a chance to rest because other people were out there at those meetings, little old ladies that didn't look like us. They were there knocking on those doors. They were camping outside these people's homes. We went to McConnell's home. We stood out there and we rallied out there. You can't be afraid if you're going to make changes. And the people who need the Equal Rights Amendment have got to stand up and be stronger than anybody else. And you got to have some serious talks with the men in your lives. And you know how to deny if they don't do what they need to do. So let's get busy. Let's get busy.
Can you tell more what it means to be a peace terrorist and how can that work on my generation?
Well, repeat the question. Oh,
peace terrorist. Can you explain more on how to be a peace terrorist and work for his generation?
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for the question. That also promotes my book. The peace terrorist. It certainly means that you're not using violence in order to accomplish what you want to do. That's why peace is in the front of it. And it's kind of a play on words. You know, when we were out on this ocean and they were treating us like, you know, we were violent terrorists, but we were actually there on behalf of peace in the Middle East, then we remained peaceful people, even though we were treated, you know, as terrorists. So I think it just means that you go out there and you're willing to stand up and do what you have to do, but remember how people made change during the civil rights movement. It wasn't hitting somebody up against their head. It wasn't fighting on the schoolyard. It was doing the positive things you knew that would accomplish things, not only for you personally, but for the other young people around you. And then, of course, as adults, we have to be there with you and supporting you. That's why I always bring in young people. And I said, in the civil rights movement, there were young people. Oh, they weren't out there playing. They were out there serious because they stood, being killed for what they were doing. And today, young people can do so many things. They can march and aren't necessarily in the kind of danger that the young people in the civil rights movement did. So just be vigilant, but not necessarily with your fists, okay?
Hi. Dr. Williams, could you talk a little bit about the sometimes what was perceived as violent posture of black women with regard to how they fought back? Because it wasn't all, you know, the supplicant kind of nonviolent reaction. Of course, in the case of Ida B. Wells, she had her printing presses, and she's the one that coined the phrase, a Winchester has a place of honor in the home of every African-American, as well as the black women of Montgomery who executed a flawless bus boycott for a year, which brought, you know, that city to its knees, basically bankrupting it to the tune of $1 million, which is, I mean, they actually used their power to leverage, not negotiate, but leverage to make these people understand that they were not going to just accept supplicantly this kind of treatment in this country. So there was a lot. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, some of the high points of history where black women really exerted their power?
Absolutely. There were also young women at Florida A&M University in Gainesville who shut their city down. We kind of forget them because we think in terms of Montgomery all the time. But one of the most powerful things, I think, to the gun is that we spend where we are honored, where we are respected. And I think that's what Montgomery and Gainesville and many of the movements did, Nashville and others. When we realize we can do without all the St. John's and we can do without all the Jimmy Choo's. I had some of those and they feel awful. They're worse than any other shoes. And I they're sitting there still. I spend all my money on them and then I get some comfortable shoes that make sense. So we have to learn to spend where we are respected because that has a most powerful impact on any society. And it's about the almighty dollar. You see, I don't care how bigoted somebody is. They understand when you don't shop there and when you don't bring them your money just any old way. Because we have a way of doing that. We go into stores that didn't allow us to try on clothes or shoes or hats some years ago. And some of them have not changed their feelings yet. So we have to know who they are. We have to study to know things. You know, we can't just say, oh, well, I don't want to shop there. We have to know. Are these the grandchildren of that person who disrespected me? And are these grandchildren changed or are they doing the same thing that their grandparents did? Now, as Susan said again, you know, we could take all the guns in our community that we want. We still cannot, you know, fight away the enemy effectively. And we got to stop thinking of everybody other than us being the enemy. Because sometimes, you know, there's the enemy within. We have enemies within our community. We have enemies in this administration. And we have to understand that and not expect it. We have enemies on the Supreme Court. We have enemies among, you know, women. So we have to study to know with whom we're dealing and what's going to impact them. So I don't suggest we use violence. I know that violence sometimes is used against us. It was used against our parents, our grandparents, and our great-grandparents. Irene Morgan was a young woman who had just come out of, you know, losing her child and was on her way to the doctor in Virginia. Her, those of you who are lawyers will know about that case. But she didn't study nonviolence like all the people down south you're hearing about. She did what she had to do. And in that case, she had to fight, violent fight, to keep her seat on that bus. Because she sat in on a bus before Rosa Parks did. But she had to physically fight. It was sort of like that song, I shot the sheriff, but I didn't shoot his deputy. She shot the sheriff, you know. So sometimes it may be necessary. But as a rule, we want to follow in the footsteps of Dr. Martin Luther King and those who did so many things for us nonviolently.
So that's going to do it for us and this forum. And today at the City Club, we have been enjoying a forum with Reverend Dr. E. Faye Williams, Esquire, President and CEO of the National Congress of Black Women, Incorporated, and Susan L. Hall, Director of Community Relations and Curator at the Cleveland History Center of the Western Reserve Historical Society. Community partners for today's forum are Equality Ohio, Global Cleveland, the National Action Network, GCC, and the National Congress of Black Women, Incorporated. We appreciate your partnership. Additionally, we welcome guests at tables hosted by the AIDS Healthcare Foundation, the AIDS Task Force of Greater Cleveland, Ohio Taxpayers for Lower Drug Prices, the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland, the United Way of Greater Cleveland. Lastly, we welcome students from Brecksville Broadview Heights High School, Citizens Leadership Academy, the Flow Homeschool Co-op, James Ford Rhodes High School Scholars, and the St. Martin's de Porres High School. Student participation in City Club forums is provided by many foundations, including the William E. Wise Foundation. We thank all of you for being here today. And that brings us to the end of today's forum. Thank you, Dr. Reverend E. Faye Williams and Ms. Hall. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here today.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.
Production and distribution of City Club forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.